Ladies and gentlemen, Investor Talk is back with an update with Jorge Ganoza, CEO of Fortuna Silver. We all struggle and fight in an insane market. The better to have a company that is making even in those market a profit. Nice to see you there for an update.
Thank you, Jan, and nice to be in the program again.
You're very welcome. So let's have a look at your second quarter numbers. And we start with the biggest number, and this is obviously the sales. They came in at 167 million compared to 182 million in the previous quarter. I think this is can be attributed to some extent to the prices that came down, but maybe other reasons. Do you have an explanation?
Yeah, no. Basically, sales are impacted by metal prices. This is a business that's driven by physical delivery, right? And I can point out that up to the first half of the year, our delivery of gold and silver production is right with our guidance. So well within our expectations, up to the first half of the year, for the first 6 months, we have delivered 129,000 ounces of gold and 3.3 million ounces of silver, which is right in the middle of the range we guided for the at the beginning of the year, right? So sales are a reflection of that metal production and prices, right? So, you know, really from our perspective, no surprises as we deliver the metal we promised for the period, right?
Yes. And we saw also the effects of the inflation. We spoke about this in our recent interviews that is clearly having an effect and driving the all-in sustaining costs a bit upwards. But still, you managed to keep in the range, although at the upper end. I have here some numbers. Lindero came in at 1,151, a real cash bringer in those times. Yaramoko, more expensive, 1,565. San Jose 1541 for silver and Kayoma 18.19. Still a good achievement under those inflationary circumstances.
Yes, and the important thing is that we have managed to keep cost within the range that we guided at the beginning of the year, right? So we provided the market an expectation for the year with respect to where our costs are gonna be. And that's where we are. So our lowest cost operation is Lindero, as you pointed out, or all-in sustaining cost hovering around 1100, 1150. Our highest cost gold mine is Yaramoko today with around $1,500 per ounce all-in sustaining. But I can point out that for the first 6 months of the year, the cost at Yaramoko is $1,300. So, you know, there are things that impact cost in the quarters. Sometimes we have one-time events and whatnot. But for the first 6 months, costs at the Yaramoko mine are $1,300 per ounce. They spiked a bit in the second quarter, but, you know, tracking within guidance. And our silver mines, you know, San Jose came in at $15 per ounce. You know, we expect costs to remain in that range for now. And San Jose is always a higher cost operation Kayoma with respect to San Jose. We expect to continue to see costs in the, you know, $16 to $18 per ounce range, right?
Yes, okay. And now let's have a look at the bottom line, so-called, where investors always focus. But in my view, this is not always the point where you should look. Your net profit came in at a low 1.68 million in the second quarter compared to nearly 27 million. And that caused, I think, the stock to drop. But if we dig deeper and have a look at the cash flow, what your operations are bringing in, then it looks still very healthy and nice. I have here in the second quarter 47.42 million operational cash flow versus 33 million and something in the first quarter, although the taxes were higher in the first quarter. So those are really nice cash generating operations, even under those pressured prices.
Yes, and you know, as you pointed out, our net income came in at a positive $1.7 million, $2 million adjusted. There was an expectation in the consensus of analysts that we would be able to come with 6 cents per share. We came in at two cents per share, so that was a disappointment. Yes. But, you know, our net income was impacted by a series of factors. First, we had a one-time write-off of inventories at our Yaramoko mine. Those are low-grade ore stockpiles that we have carrying inventory. And we made, you know, revisions and adjustments and took a write-down of around $4 million. That's an accounting write-down, a write-down in the value of those inventories. That doesn't mean that ore is not going to run through the mill and generate a margin. But we carried those ores at higher value. So we took that write-down, but that ore is going to run through the mill. No. So, but it's still a reduction of $4 million in the value of those inventories. And then, from April to June, silver price declined $3, and zinc price, which is a byproduct for us, declined from $1.90 per pound to $1.45 per pound. All of our silver, 100% of the 3.3 million ounces that we produced in the first half of the year, is sold in concentrates. And I don't want to make this a complex explanation for the audience, but when you sell concentrates, you get something that's called provisional pricing. And you get a final pricing on the metal you delivered in concentrates a month after. So if prices decline, you get negative adjustments with respect to the metal you delivered to the smelters and to the traders. If prices go up, it plays in your favor. In this quarter, because silver declined $3 from April to June, beginning of the quarter to the end of the quarter, and because zinc had such a steep decline as well, we had to take adjustments on the provisional pricing. That plus the write down in the value of inventories amounts to roughly, you know, an additional $12 million that impact our net income, right? But if you peel and dig a bit deeper, we generated $22 million of free cash flow in the period. We had a strong operating income. Our mines all were able to generate strong operating income that translated eventually into a strong free cash flow from operations, right? So, you know, yes, we all look at earnings per share, but earnings per share can be impacted by accounting and non-cash items like write-down of the value of inventories. No, but in a quarter where most of our peers, peer mining companies, were deep in the red with respect to income and earnings in the P&L, we were able to, you know, show a small profit and strong free cash flow generation. So I, all in all, I think it was a strong quarter for the company and very misunderstood by the market. Yeah.
I think so also. And you gave me the keyword already, the free cash flow. You mentioned the number of nearly 22 million. This compares to 9.6 million in the first quarter. So I think we can be really happy with those numbers in this market. But you have to have a closer look at the paperwork, at the results, and many people don't do this. Let's come to Séguéla. I got the information from your Marcus video that it is now at roughly 70% complete, right? And once this is done, Jorge, then the free cash flow will automatically increase because your investment is done then. So I think the next two or three quarters, will still draw some cash, but then it will come back with a vengeance.
Yeah, I like how you're framing it. You know, we made last year the Roxul acquisition, which was a controversial, you know, transaction. We always knew it was going to be controversial. It was going to be, but we decided to take short-term pain for long-term gain, right? And the main driver behind the Roxul acquisition and business combination last year was Séguéla. We have a high degree of conviction in the view that Séguéla is a flagship asset, and once in operation, will be a significant free cash flow contributor for years to come. Today, we have close to 10 years in reserves and resources. No, and we could feed our life of mine plan with those inventories for 10 years plus right now. And it continues to grow. And as you pointed out, as of the end of June for Q2, we had 66% completion on the construction. And I can share with you now as well that, you know, by now, in mid-August, we're a little over 70% complete with construction. So we are on time, on budget. And I want to highlight that we are managing an on-time, on-budget construction in a very challenging construction environment. We monitor constructions in the mining sector all over the world, and we see that many of those projects are going through, you know, delays on timeline and CapEx escalations. That is not our case at Séguéla. Out of the $173 million CapEx, we have accrued already close to slightly over $100 million. And the project is on target to deliver first gold mid-2023. So I am very happy, and, you know, Fortuna shareholders should be very happy with the delivery our team is giving us at the Séguéla construction.
Let me show to our audience some recent pictures from your presentation. Here's some pictures from your presentation, and it looks really pretty much advanced here. Here down there are the CIL tanks, transmission line construction. If you like to comment on it.
Yes. I mean, if we break down the construction on excavations, concrete, and steel structures, with respect to excavations, we are basically complete, no? 95-98% complete with all the excavations of the construction. With respect to placement of concrete, I don't have the exact figure in my head right now, but it's around 70%. Also, 70-80% of all the concrete that needs to be placed has been placed. And the phase we're in right now is steel structures. That work started in the second half of August. As you see, the tanks are erected now, but at this month of August now, most of the work and for the next couple of months is gonna be erection of steel structures. We already have key equipment arriving on site. We have screens, primary crusher, furnaces, I mean, different various equipment already arriving on site. So all the procurement is on time, arrivals are on schedule. So, you know, the construction is going really well and speaks lots about the ability of the team to do good planning and a solid team of mine builders putting lots of years of experience to work, right? And that's why the project is advancing so well. No, I'm very happy with the way the construction is going. And again, I can stress that once in production mid next year, Séguéla is a cash cow for the company, right? It's a flagship property with a 10 years plus in the long, continues to grow. So I'm very excited. We're all very excited about Séguéla joining our production asset portfolio.
Jorge, a more general question. The market is very tough right now, as we said at the beginning. And I know from your other video that you rather focus on your current portfolio to develop it. But if, you could get maybe another 1 million ounces in West Africa somewhere, because we have many stressed assets now. Would you maybe take it?
You know, we have to be disciplined, right? So I'll tell you our line of thought to answer that question. I believe that the best thing we can do for our shareholders is harvest the portfolio and unlock the value that we have in our portfolio, right? So with the Roxgold acquisition, we brought, you know, not just Séguéla as a growth opportunity. You know, we brought in the Roxgold acquisition, and we closed the acquisition in early July, end of June. In September, we were making the construction decision on Séguéla, right? So that's value for our shareholders that we are going to start materializing soon when that mine starts generating those strong free cash flows we're talking about. That mine is going to generate 140,000, 150,000 ounces of gold in the initial years. At an all-in sustaining cost, you know, our expectation is under $1,000 per ounce, right? So a high margin operation with significant meaningful production and reserves for 10 years plus. So. But then there is exploration opportunity around Séguéla. And I don't think the market has really grasped, because the market is distracted with all of this, you know, difficult market environment we're in. But the growth opportunities that we have at Séguéla are tremendous. Séguéla was a 400,000 ounce deposit 3 years ago. And today is a mine going into operation with over a year of reserves, you know, 1 million plus ounces. So, you know, and we see that mineralization remains open with many opportunities in front of us. So we need to capture those. We need to capture a lot of that. We have the Bosuda exploration property in southeastern Burkina Faso. And we are advancing there as well. We are working on our, after we decided to put more drilling before doing a resource estimation. The Roxgold team wanted to do a resource estimation. We decided to, you know, fund more drilling before we can produce something, and then look at the options for that project. Continue with exploration, build a development case, or you know. So we're looking at that. At Yaramoko, we also have opportunities that we're pursuing on the exploration side. And we have other exploration ground in Ivory Coast where we are, you know, advancing with exploration. So before we want to grow outside the farm, we have to make sure that for the benefit of our shareholders, we have captured a lot of the value in the portfolio. In the LATAM side, we also had opportunities. We're currently drilling in Argentina, a very exciting deposit close to the border with Chile. We have brownfields drilling at the Lindero mine, at the Arizaro porphyry, which is a twin porphyry deposit 3 kilometers away from our mine. We're currently drilling there. In Mexico, we've been drilling a prospect in north central Mexico called Baborigame. There are lots of things going on, right? So I think there is value in the portfolio that we need to really try to capture before we go to look for value somewhere else. Having said that, in this business, you also have to remain opportunistic, right? If we see the right opportunity and we really see deep value, you know, we will certainly consider it, no? But if you ask me where our focus is, our focus is not right now in looking for value outside of a portfolio. Our focus is looking for value within the portfolio.
Thank you for the update, Jorge, and it's time for people who have a closer look at the paperworks, and they should capture the opportunity, and I'm pretty sure sooner or later the market will realize that here is a big value in gold and silver, and it will pick up, and let's hope that it will happen soon. Thank you for today, and have a good weekend in Lima.
Thank you. Thank you to you and your audience.
Thank you. Bye-bye.